is mandatory for all the sessions, so please submit the feedback forms without fail. Right now, I request everyone to mute the microphone to avoid background noises that may distract you from listening the talk. You can enter your queries and comments in the chat box and will be discussed after the presentation. Now I would like to welcome Dr. S. Umadevi, Faculty of Botany and convener of IIC, to deliver the welcome address. Dr. Uma, please.
Am I audible, ma'am?
Yeah, you are audible.
A warm good evening to all the honorable dignitaries who are the part of this short-term course jointly organized by IQAC and IIC of Sri Ayyappa College for Women, Nagarkoil. On this pleasant and colorful evening, it's my privilege and honor to welcome the resource person, Professor Purushottam Reddy, former professor of political science, Osmania University, India's eminent environmentalist, political scientist, and development activist. He is an accomplished academician with several published works to his credit. Today, we are privileged to have an opportunity to listen to him this evening on human rights and disaster management. I, on behalf of IQAC and IIC of Sri Ayyappa College of Women, I welcome you, sir. I'm profusely elated to welcome our respected principal, Dr. K.V. Jayashree, who is the backbone of this institution. Her support and guidance strongly promote the success of our institution. On behalf of IQAC and IIC, I welcome you, ma'am. It's my honor to welcome IQAC coordinator, Dr. K. Meena, IIC president, Dr. Smita Nair, organizing secretaries, Dr. M. R. Meera, Dr. Janata Kumari, Dr. T. Anita, and all other members of IIC to this session. I also welcome all the participants for sparing a few hours of their valuable time to participate in this short-term course. I, on behalf of IQAC and IIC of Sri Ayyappa College for Women, welcome all of you to the session. Welcome.
Thank you, Dr. Uma. Professor Purushottaman Reddy, former professor of political science, Osmania University, is an eminent environmentalist, academician, and development activist of India. A multifaceted personality with many successes, widely known as man of the masses and an environmentalist. Professor's long public life and activism spans across the environmental and developmental areas such as sustainable agriculture, environmental policies and public policies on sustainable development, Panchayat Raj and rural development, urban studies, restoration of damaged ecosystems, etc. He held various academic positions in Osmania University as professor, head of the department, and chairman, board of studies in political science department. He was the director for Center for Environmental Studies of the university. He remains a source of inspiration for fellow academicians and students. He calls the society as his lab, and most part of his life was dedicated for the cause of society and environment. Professor Reddy has emerged as one of the eminent environmentalists whose name has become synonymous with environmentalism in the states of Telangana and Andhra Pradesh. He works with the aim of making environmental studies an integrated interdisciplinary stream, which helps in making the earth clean and green. He swung into an action after Bhopal gas disaster in 1984. Since then, he carried out many landmark environmental struggles, namely against the establishment of a nuclear power plant at Nagarjuna Sagar Dam in 1987-88, a struggle against two export-oriented mechanized slaughterhouses in Medak district in 1990, then numerous campaigns against industrial pollution, striving to make environmental rights like right to clean air, right to clean water, right to livelihood, a meaningful proposition based on Gandhian principles. Professor Reddy is currently working on public policies which would lead to popularizing sustainable development in India and on alternative development models on the lines of World Commission on Environment and Development. So I humbly request you to share your ideas to us. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, madam. Am I audible?
Yeah, sir, you are audible.
Thank you. Thank you very much. At the outset, I am extremely happy to be able to speak to university and college teachers in Kerala. And here in Hyderabad, for more than three decades, I was always a regular faculty at the Osmani University Human Resource Development Center. And my areas, as already pointed out, are environment and sustainable development, citizens' initiative struggles. And not only I was studying these topics, but basically I have been instrumental in filing a large number of public interest litigation cases and always winning. I never lost a case. And that is because whenever we take up an issue, we do a lot of research. We talk to the people, we understand their aspirations, and we go very deep into the subject and try to understand about the policy, its impact, and where did the path go wrong, what needs to be done. And I always considered society as my lab, because we are all social scientists. Here I just would like to give you the example. For example, a chemistry professor, after taking the class, goes to the lab, that is the chemistry lab. Similarly, botany, zoology, microbiology, you know, everyone has, most of the science professors, they have their own labs. Whereas for a social scientist, society is the lab. So it is very important that a political science teacher or a public administration, sociology, economics, you know, we all need to go into the society and interact with the people and be with them in their hour of crisis. Friends, today we have a very important topic, and that is understanding disasters from the human rights perspective. So to begin with, I wish to go into, I would like to trace human rights through the ages, and this I can assure you it won't exceed more than 10 minutes, but it's very important for us to understand. Whenever we are talking about human rights, naturally we are reminded of democracy. In fact, we can never have our human rights safeguarded without democracy, and therefore democracy becomes the basic medium to understand human rights. And whenever we are talking about democracy, the first thing that comes to us is, in Greece, Athenian democracy. And Athenian democracy those days, it had a run for about 500 years. I'm not saying it was a 100% like our modern day democracy. It was not based on universal adult franchise. There was slavery in Athens, but nearly 2/3 of the people were citizens. And it was direct democracy, though the rulers were elected. So whenever they were, there was an important topic, people would gather at the town hall or in front of the Senate hall. And anyone with any good idea was always welcome to give their inputs. Athens was a successful democracy in that sense. And their greatest ruler was Pericles. Pericles, really, he was there for nearly 33 decades. And unfortunately, at about the same time, there was a war between Athens and Sparta. And it so happened that there was a disease known as plague. Plague had struck Athens, and it killed a large number of elected representatives, unfortunately. And Pericles also perished in that. After his death, because he was a great warrior also, and a great builder, and he was always with the poor. And it appeared, historians say, that he would have been endlessly elected. I mean, that is the word they use when it comes to understanding Pericles' popularity. At about the same time in India, we had Vaishali in today's Bihar state. 2500 years ago, there was a republic, a small, we call it as a town. It was definitely not a city, slightly bigger than a modern day village. And it was direct democracy again, though the rulers, a few people, would be elected with the consent of the population. But here it was universal adult franchise in India. So all the people of Vaishali would gather and elect, and they would actively participate. And that was the strength of Vaishali. After the collapse of Athenian democracy, whenever we are talking about democracy, idealism, or when we want to delve into the major issues of political thought, we are reminded of Socrates, then Plato, Aristotle. The trio of them, the three of them together, you know, Socrates, his student Plato, and his student Aristotle, they have laid the foundation for modern Western political thought. And they have enabled the people to think about basic issues. And we always take those three names with a lot of respect, though, except for Aristotle, the later part, they were not very much known for their big contribution for democracy, but they were great thinkers and they stood for certain values, particularly the right of individuals to think independently. We are all reminded of Socrates, you know, when he was asked to take poison. And why was he given poison? Because he was raising certain questions which were causing inconvenience to the rulers of the day. And he was an independent thinker, always pondering, questioning, and the way he was questioning, it was not to the liking of the rulers, and therefore he was silenced. That's unfortunate. But then Socrates was a great philosopher, and Plato was a great idealist, you all know. His book, particularly Republic, it throws up such beautiful ideas on education, on ideal state, on justice. And then we have Aristotle, you know, who those days he took the trouble of reading 126 constitutions. Now here, let us be very clear. When I mention 126 countries and constitutions, those days it were mostly Greek city-states and a few states in Italy. And the size of the state was very small. They were in fact slightly more than modern-day communes. And the very fact that he went very deep into the question of constitutions, he was tracing the idea of stability, democracy, and other values. After this, there's a huge gap. After the collapse of Athens, particularly, the entire Greece, you know, all the city-states in Greece, they fell one by one. And an empire was, you know, during Alexander time, and subsequently, Alexander was vanquished. I mean, his government was vanquished subsequently by the Romans. So Alexander's regime gave way to the Roman Empire, and we see the collapse of democracy once again. And for nearly 1800 years, Greece did not witness democracy. And same is the position with regards to most of the kingdoms, in most of the states in Europe, particularly, UK and then America. The next important date trying to understand the concept of human rights and democracy, it takes us to UK, and we are all reminded of the, to begin with, Magna Carta, and subsequently the glorious English Revolution, which resulted in the transfer of power from the British monarch to, I am not saying 100% democracy, but definitely it was a step in the direction of democracy, because there was a transfer of power from one person, that is the monarch, to a larger group. We may call them as aristocrats, the nobility, because those days the British Parliament was controlled by vested interests of that time, the landed gentry and so on. And definitely there was this transfer of power. But subsequently, after 1688, the British monarchy became a constitutional head. And from that date onwards, British Parliament was definitely on its own, and it was exercising powers. It was responsive to the needs of the people. Friends, we need to understand that after the English Revolution, because that was the period when great English poets like Byron, you know, they were writing about the freedom of the individual, and this ignited the minds of youngsters in UK, and simultaneously there was a group, it had come into being in France, and this group was known as the Encyclopedic group. It was nearly a group of 100 members, great thinkers, activists, writers, poets, they were all there, and they were stalwarts like Voltaire, Rousseau. And in England, it was John Locke who, for the first time, explained the concept of a social contract. That is, he explained that the citizens come together to form into a contract, and they elect a government. And if the government doesn't function as per the needs of the people, if they fail to protect the fundamental rights of the people, or the basic rights or human rights, then the people have the choice of displacing the government. They can throw out the government. So these were the ideas which were, we can say, they were trying to liberate the minds in Europe. But simultaneously, please remember, friends, the reactionary forces are also constantly active. So that's the reason we see that in Europe, several countries become democratic, but again lapse into monarchy. And this is a, you know, like a pendulum, you know, it goes on till the advent of the 20th century. From after this, of course, slightly before in terms of dating, 1776, the American War of Independence, American Declaration of Independence. And there we have a couple of people, particularly Thomas Jefferson. He is the one who drafted the American Declaration of Independence, and he also became the third president of United States. But more than that, he was a great thinker, and he was a visionary in the sense he was hoping that America as a land shall always be available for all the freedom-loving citizens of the world. That is, in one of the speeches, he declares that if in any part of the world we Democrats or human rights activists are tortured, they can safely come to America, because this is the land of freedom. And he was hoping that it will stand out as a safety safety haven for all those who love freedom. And American Constitution, as all of you are aware, has been guided by John Locke also. And in addition to that, the theory of separation of powers. Definitely, John Locke spoke about that, but the finality was given by Montesquieu. So the legislature, executive, judiciary, and a very important concept of checks and balances, and ultimately build on the rights of the people. And they have incorporated judicial review. Judicial review is very, very important to protect the rights, because executives, believe me, friends, they have this tendency to exceed their limits. In India, for example, because I'm giving your local example, it is, if at all, we, the free citizens of India, if we are threatened, it's only because of the executive excesses. I request all of you to recall the emergency days in India, when Mrs. Indira Gandhi imposed emergency. And, you know, our fundamental rights were put in the deep freezer, and a status, you know, midnight knocks, and our leaders were arrested, put behind the bars. And for 18 months, it was nothing but a reign of terror. A few pockets in the country escaped this extremism, depending upon the liberality of the local leaders. And one of the states was Andhra Pradesh, where the emergency excesses were not witnessed. I'm sure Kerala also is one wonderful area where human rights are protected. After this, we come to 20th century, and all of us have been a witness to the rise of dictators, you know, Hitler, Mussolini, and I'm very sorry to say, Stalin, though he came up in the name of a progressive ideology, but still, dictators are dictators. They love absolute power, and they would like to suppress everybody who questions them. So these three dictators apart, we had emperor in Japan, you know, Japan also was dictatorial. In addition to all this, we had imperialists, you know, except that, for example, British imperialism, you know, they thought they were fighting for freedom, but in India they were resorting into repression. They were suppressing it. No, I don't think we can ever forget Jallianwala Bagh. So when we look at all these simultaneously operating, the First World War and the Second World War, and particularly as a political scientist, I am shocked the way United States of America decided to bomb Hiroshima and subsequently Nagasaki. I don't understand where was the need to drop those two bombs. Except in a war, you know, everything was fair, and we can understand Japanese bombing Pearl Harbor. But the Americans had already taken revenge, and where was the question of this extra suppression? Only thing is, it was evident that Americans had developed a nuclear bomb towards the end of the Second World War, and they wanted to demonstrate. In other words, they wanted to promote themselves from a power status to a superpower. And for that, they wanted somewhere it had to be dropped, and they thought it is better to drop in Japan, because they did not want to destroy Europe. And they dropped in Japan, and not satisfied with one bomb, 3 days later, another bomb in Nagasaki, 1945, August 9th. You know, together in those two cities, more than 400,000 people were, you know, I won't say they were killed, but they simply evaporated in the intensity of heat that was generated there. And you can imagine, well, apart from that, millions of people were persecuted and eliminated by Hitler and Mussolini and Stalin. And what is the big justification? So, though after the First World War, an international organization was created by name League of Nations, it failed to take off for various reasons. But after the Second World War, the nations of the world came together once again and made a second attempt. And this time it was very clear that they wanted to protect the human rights. And that's why the United Nations Declaration of Human Rights, that's very important, and we need to take note of. Friends, after the Second World War, I wish to go on record when I appreciate United Nations. It started very shakily, but very soon it consolidated. They definitely tried and succeeded in preventing a Third World War. But the world was not saved. Nearly about 70 to 80 regional wars were fought between North Korea and South Korea, North Vietnam, South Vietnam, the Arab-Israel war, India-Pakistan wars, and all kinds of Iran-Iraq war, and some of these wars went into more than a decade. And if we calculate all the battles that took place even in Africa between the nations, more than 70 battles have taken place, and it's now nearly 70 years. More than 70 years UN has come into being, and more than 70 battles were fought and millions of people killed and eliminated. But still, United Nations provided a place for the confronting nations to come together across the table, and they provided a place and a situation where dialogue can be created. The Security Council was constantly, depending upon the situation, it was in session, and it facilitated a dialogue. I consider the role of the UN as a great happening, a great situation. It speaks volumes about we human beings, our capacity to rise to the occasion and try to bring the confronting parties together and to a process of discussion and deliberation. Several issues have been addressed. But at the same time, not satisfied with just addressing the transboundary conflicts, United Nations has been working on a holistic approach. For example, it has been working and trying to ensure that everybody's essential needs are taken care of. For example, when it comes to food, they created an organization known as Food and Agriculture Organization, FAO. Similarly, for children, for education, for scientific advancement, for every conceivable thing, United Nations has, it had risen to the occasion, and they provided it. They created a facility, an organization, and they have been trying to make the world a much better place to live in. But in spite of all this, some of the nations not being fair enough. For example, I'll give you, in many of the international conventions pertaining environment, I'm going to come into it. We see the nations of the world, competing with each other and expressing solidarity on global environmental issues, and sometimes it appears as if the international conferences are like a debating forum where there are presidents and prime ministers of nations compete with each other to draw the attention of the global community and get a major applause. And they declare and sign all the global conventions, but when they go back, only a few of them implement what they conceded in a global conference. When it comes to implementation part, the performance of the nation states in their own country is very, very negligible. At least we don't see that kind of enthusiasm, and I know India is no exception. Okay, friends, I wish to go into the subject of environment because that is very important for us to basically to understand. Now, for the benefit of my friends, I request all of you to take as many points as possible. Not that you do not know, but in a gathering like this and an occasion like this, it is customary that even I would take down notes. So the subject of environment, it started after the Industrial Revolution, when Europe particularly, when they started producing for the rest of the world, heavy industrialization. And those days, industry was equated with development, and industrialization per se was conceived as development, and therefore no questions asked on the siting criteria or about the what we call the air pollution or water pollution or other waste dumping here and there. So industry per se being understood as development, industrialized countries were viewed as developed countries. So that's how Europe took the lead, and they started producing for the rest of the world. They wanted markets, and almost all the European countries, the leading European countries, they ventured out, the French, the Danes, the Danish people, the Portuguese, the Spanish people, of course the British, everybody ventured out, and they tried to take possession of any land anywhere in the world and converted it into a colony. It started with the 17th century, but it went on into, their hold on the colonies continued till the 20th century. And they were fleecing the colonies for natural resources, and they were also dumping their finished products. For them, the colony became a ready-made market. But in Europe, they were polluting the air, the water, and the land. The similar thing happened in America also, because see, ultimately, when America was made known to the world by Columbus, and subsequently in the year 1776, when it became independent, when it declared independent, there was heavy migration from Europe. And they went there, and they started the same kind of developmental activity what they were pursuing in Europe. And very soon, America also, United States of America also became a highly industrialized country. And like their counterparts in Europe, these industries were polluting the air, the water, and the land. It was in that kind of a situation, one environmental scientist by name Rachel Carson, a lady environmental biologist. She came from a very poor family, and her parents were living besides an industrial area, and every day they were exposed to the increasing levels of air pollution. And when I was reading her articles and her book, The Silent Spring, the most important book in the world, a book which can be described as having launched environmentalism, that book is known as The Silent Spring, and Rachel Carson is the author. Now this particular book, in that book she traces many things, particularly she goes to the extent of tracing the impact of DDT on the food chains and food webs and ultimately life itself. And very clearly she in a way, it's a scientific paper, and predicted that if this continued, it would become increasingly difficult for life to continue to sustain itself. And that is why the word, the silent spring. Now the word spring here means the spring of life. And the spring of life, which normally we assume to be eternal, Rachel Carson projected that in the days to come, if situations did not change, the spring of life is likely to become silent. That is, the planet Earth would not be any more favorable for life itself. Rachel Carson's book, I always say that it has sensitized America, and it caught the imagination of the United Nations. And one great paper, that is the New York Times, it had serialized the entire book. And imagine way back in 1962-63, imagine America, that was the time when John F. Kennedy was there, and America was, bubbling with ideas. There was Martin Luther King, And there was Ralph Nader. So, and all, you know, Ralph Nader was a consumer activist, a lawyer by profession, and Martin Luther King was a great, you know, Gandhian, follower of Gandhian, and what a great leader he was. He inspired everyone. And, you know, particularly I recall his speech given, you know, entitled, "I Have a Dream." Yes, Martin Luther King had a dream where the whites and the blacks, everybody would be on the same, on a level playing ground, no discrimination. So that was America. And John F. Kennedy also was a person who can be described as one of the first major charismatic leaders of the 20th century. An extremely popular person. I was a student, you know, doing my PUC, and subsequently I was in medical college for a couple of years. And I was inspired the way he was addressing the nation and inspiring the world. So slowly he emerged as a person who could attract the thinking minds worldwide. So that was the time when the New York Times, you know, they serialized. And this book became available to millions of people through the paper also. Subsequently, I need to emphasize that this book, as already pointed out, it caught the imagination of the United Nations organization, because the headquarters being located in New York, and New York being in America, and the whole of America having awoken to the contents of the book. United Nations, in going through the pages of the book, you know, they decided to organize a global conference on the subject of environment, and they organized this in Stockholm in the year 1972. In other words, we can say the time period between the publication of the book and the Stockholm conference is a decade. But then you can imagine the kind of sensitization that took place throughout the world because of that book. But before 1972, I wish to point out that one American senator by name Gaylord, he was so impressed by the book that he took upon himself, and he individually, along with his friends, he took up a campaign. And that resulted in giving, in bestowing, or in other words, in dedicating a day for the planet Earth. And this was known as the Earth Day. And it was April 22nd, 1970. And you can, just to give you the, to gauge, to enable us to understand, that on the very first Earth Day, 350 cities worldwide, in Australia, and, you know, in other countries, they, in Europe particularly, they observed a day for the planet Earth. This is very important, because until 1970, the general public never bothered about the implications of their actions on the planet Earth. So 1972, Stockholm Conference, and that conference becomes important because that was the first major global conference, and almost all the nations of the world, they participated. And I, as an academic, I wish to bring to your notice that by virtue of that particular conference, environment as a subject was put on the on top of the agendas of the global universities. This is very important. That is, almost all the universities in Europe and America got connected with this wonderful subject of environment. Now here, friends, one plus point about the American and European universities is that the students who study there, after when they come out and when they settle down in life, they have this habit of donating immensely to the college or the university, wherever they studied. Basically, charity seems to be in the blood of Europeans and Americans. And they earn, definitely they earn a lot of money, but they also donate. And I was a witness way back in 1992, when I went to Florida, University of Florida, to give a lecture. And in that university, on the same day, one Indian couple, Gujarati Patels, they were there as guests, chief guest and guest of honor. And they donated 40 million. Indians in America donating to the universities they studied. That is it. I was so happy because, of course, our Indians have made it to the top in there also, but they also started donating to the universities. Okay, friends. And the universities worldwide connected to this subject of environment. And after that, I request all of you to note from 1972 to 1983, approximately 11-year period, it witnessed a rapid growth of interest in the subject. Almost all the departments in universities and colleges, interdisciplinary, they connected with this subject. And they started working. And in fact, United Nations itself was very pleasantly surprised to understand, okay, what's happening? Because almost every day, all the papers, all the research journals were full of articles and publications pertaining to environment. So to they did a very useful decision, that is UN. They appointed a commission to understand the growth of the knowledge. They appointed the what is known as the World Commission on Environment and Development, WCED. It's also popularly known as the Brundtland Commission, and named after the person Gro Harlem Brundtland, who was then Prime Minister of Norway. And this particular commission, it came into being in 1983, but worked for 4 years, and they submitted the report in 1987. And United Nations, after going through the report, they decided to organize another conference in order to get the world to discuss and approve the contents of the report. And this was organized in the year 1992. And this particular conference, held exactly 20 years after Stockholm, that is 72 to 92. And this conference was organized in Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. And the conference itself is known as the Earth Summit. And this was the biggest conference organized by the United Nations. There are so far nothing to beat the Earth Summit, 1992 Rio. Now, friends, coming to the contents of the World Commission on Environment and Development, this report becomes historic because this report is in two parts. The first part talks about the major environmental concerns of the planet Earth. And these are basically, most of them, most of the people are agreed that they are five in number. The first one is the depletion of the ozone layer. Second is global warming, which is resulting in climate change. Third is the loss, LOSS, loss of biodiversity. Fourth is spreading desertization. And the fifth one is the danger posed by nuclear reactors and nuclear bombs. Okay. The second part of the report is equally important. It talks about development. The first part talks about the environmental issues. In other words, the issues faced by the planet Earth. The second part, it talks about development. And it is in this second part that the word sustainable development has, for the first time, it originated. Now, what is sustainable development? By now, everybody knows. I'm not going into the details, but suffice it to say that a development which takes care of the needs of the present generation, but at the same time, the present generation should be conscious of the needs of the coming generations, because we are not the last generation to live on this planet Earth, and life has to continue. And therefore, we have an obligation towards the coming generation. Sustainable development is now the most sought after subject in the entire world. In fact, every human activity has to be directed to realize these goals. Okay. What happened at Rio? The nations of the world, they discussed and approved. And subsequently, they also approved an action plan. And this action plan, which was approved at Rio, is known as Agenda 21. Now, what is Agenda 21? It was approved in the June of 1992. Agenda 21 is a package of practices, small little initiatives to be taken by the nations of the world in order to enter the 21st century or the next millennium on an environment-friendly note. The time the world had was roughly 7.5 years. And Agenda 21 basically talks about small little initiatives like, the needed laws and the institutions that every country should have and prepare themselves to enter. Okay, friends, the next important date for us to understand is this year 2000. Year 2000, because that was, I request all of you to recall what happened 20 years ago when everybody was talking about the Y2K and they thought there would be a collapse of the internet or whatever. That did not happen, but that was a wonderful time because all of us, whenever December 31st comes, even I am very much excited because the next day would be a new year. So the dawn of the new year itself is a very exhilarating thing. But if an ordinary new year will give us so much of happiness, you can imagine the dawn of a new millennium, because all of us, we were all witness to this wonderful change from one millennium to another. A great occasion, and there were lots of hopes and aspirations. So United Nations wanted to understand the status of human development worldwide. And they commissioned another report, and it's known as the Year 2000 report. And based on the findings of this particular report, Millennium Development Goals were developed, and they were given to the rest of the world. Because UN appealed to the nations of the world that it is very important that we address the essential needs of the poorest of the poor. And these needs have been classified as being 8 major critical areas where it was important to give more attention. Okay, and the period given to the nations of the world was 15 years, and therefore the 2015 December 31st, the period ended, and that was again December 2015 was a very important meeting. That year was important because the world gave a new prescription. United Nations gave a new prescription to the rest of the world, and that is the Sustainable Development Goals. Here, for want of time, I am not going into all the details, but it's important that I focus on just a few, because these are, the first one is no poverty, second is no hunger, third is health for all. This is pandemic times, and I cannot diminish the importance of health. It's a very, very important thing, and all of us, we need to be conscious of this. Okay, friends, after this we come to education. National education policy right now is in major focus in our country. Whether this will remain just another policy or whether it will be a game changer you know, it all depends on not just the policy, but several other accompanying initiatives which the central government and the state governments are going to take. After this, we have the gender equity. And all of us know it's a matter of shame that in this country, still women are not, they are not safe. And if you look at the papers, sometimes we get a feeling whether we Indians are civilized, and all of us need to hold our heads in shame. Then we come to water. Here, access to water again is very important from human rights angle. Here, once again, friends, every goal is connected with human rights. To understand, the implication of being poor, this is the world's biggest disease. What is poverty? You know, being deprived of so many things which the mainstream society takes it for granted. And 30% of the people, particularly, you know, in India, not being on the same footage. Though we are an independent country, we have everything, fundamental rights, and things are not the same for the poorest of the poor, and they are, unfortunately, they live in the most unhealthy areas known as slums. The air they breathe is, sometimes hazardous. The water is contaminated. Particularly during the pandemic times, it is everybody's knowledge. The plight of the migrant labor and the kind of humiliation they suffered, in addition to the losing valuable source of income. And, you know, I think we are not a democratic country, and it calls for a very serious debate that a major chunk of the poorest of the poor were harassed to this degree. Then we come to electricity. This goal number 7 is electricity for all, energy for all. But energy, again, the source of the energy should be clean. The source of the energy should be renewable, clean, and it should be accessible. Access to energy, you know, it should be viable, affordable, accessible, and the source of the energy itself, it should be clean. Then automatically we come to the next one, that is right to work. Right to work with dignity. This is very important. After 70, more than 70 years of the working of the Constitution, this country is not, we have not realized fraternity. The dignity of the individual has not been taken care of. So at the surface level, we appear to be respecting each other, but in fact, we have layers of exploitation in this country, and it's a matter of concern. Then we come to goal number 9. 9 talks about innovation, industry, infrastructure. And it is here that we can be more creative, particularly in the context of today's national environment policy. We are talking about vocational education, skill education. We are talking about choice-based credit systems, multiple exits and entries. You know, we are recognizing that, the youngsters of today, they need to study as per their aptitude, their aspiration, their desires, because ultimately it is they who are going to live. And it is their future, and therefore their education, they need to be masters. But are we going to ensure quality? If this has to happen, then we need to be taking care of the creditization of different vocational streams. For example, agriculture. If a student wants to take leave and take into for the production of spices, for example, in Kerala, which is God's own land, very beautiful. Kerala provides spices for the world. But if a student wants to take it up as an avocation, the system should provide creditization, and that too on an absolute level playing ground basis. It has to be specific. So if a student takes 6 months off or 1 year off and studies agriculture, growing or going in for spices, growth and trade and everything, he would not be losing an academic year, but at the same time, he'll be earning the same credits as if he had been studying in the formal stream. Okay, like this, we need to be innovative, renewable energy, solar energy, wind energy, geothermal, tidal, bio, and so many other innovative renewable energy sources, where including waste management, it's such a big subject. It can create millions of jobs in this country. In addition to this, rainwater harvesting, organic farming, natural farming, so many innovative, and we can make India a much better place. And provided all of us agree and let us move in the direction of sustainability, in the spirit of India's freedom struggle. Once again, let us revive the spirit of India's freedom struggle and recall the sacrifices of the great visionaries who framed the constitution, like Dr. Ambedkar. And we need to prepare ourselves and go into the future. Then after this, we come to reducing the income gap between the right now those who are earning whether it's the factory or industry or wherever. This income disparities, it is there already in the directive of principles of state policy, but we need to be, the gap between the highest income and the lowest income, it cannot be such wide as to put the poorest of the poor, those with low income, into, we cannot be pushing them into desperation. We go a little further, we are talking about sustainable cities, and it is here that India must do a lot of homework. Not a single city in this country is worth livable. All of us are a witness to what's happening to all the cities in North America, North India, North India, right from Punjab to Bengal. Every Indian city is, the people are forced to breathe. They have no choice. They are breathing poisons. And Delhi is horrible. Delhi and all its entire suburbs, the metropolitan area, the capital, national capital region, is the worst polluted in the entire world. And what have we done to Delhi in the name of development? Similarly, when it rains, Bombay is out, Chennai is out, Bangalore lakes are burning. And Hyderabad, all the roads are like corridors of smoke. Last year, we were very sorry to witness and read in the paper and also witness on the TV about the devastation that took place in Kerala. All this was man-made. We the rulers tend to escape saying that hum kya kar sakte, what is it we can do if nature has... Yeah, let us not put the blame on nature. Whether it is the Himalayan region or Eastern Ghats, Western Ghats or Kerala, everywhere it is human beings, we the people, we are responsible, and all these disasters are basically man-made. We go a little further and we talk about responsible consumption. What is it we are trying to explain here? What are the basic needs of an individual? Should we go about just because we happen to have a lot of money? All those who have access to money, they should be more reasonable, more responsible. They can't be purchasing the entire mall and converting their homes into storehouses. Okay, let us all remember Mahatma Gandhi. One of his most famous dictum is that there is enough in nature to meet the needs of all, but not sufficient to satisfy the greed of the few. The propertied class, the income, high income groups in India, they have to go in for a big time paradigm shift, and they need to reduce their personal expenditure. They need to become charitable. And they have to learn a lot from our educated counterparts in America and Europe, where they donate very heavily for global causes. They have nothing to do with the poverty in India, but they were donating. So why can't we do the same thing? And in a country like India, if some people become billionaires, the political system should sit and think, this was not intended, this was not the spirit of the constitution. This is a violation of the basic structure of Indian constitution. It was never intended to be so. In fact, the directive principles of state policy very clearly speak about the political system in this country shall work so as to ensure that there is no concentration of wealth. But unfortunately, we are a witness to the rise of the billionaires, which is a matter of shame for the entire country. Now, after this, we come to climate remediation. And I already mentioned to you here, more than billions of jobs can be created if only the governments are sensitive. And then we come to goal number 14 and 15. They talk about life in water and life on land. In other words, it talks about regarding protection of biodiversity. Goal number 16 is the most important thing. That's why I wanted to focus on this. Without goal number 16, it is impossible to take care of the human rights. Goal number 16 talks about democracy, rule of law, level playing ground, strong institutions. Rule of law basically means equality before law and equal application of laws. And that only means that can happen only when there are strong institutions. When we don't have to go with the recommendation letter from our MLA or MP, where a citizen of India should be able to easily walk into a government department and he or she should be treated with respect. They should be offered a chair, and after they are seated, the officer should politely learn from them what is the problem, and they need to respond immediately and address their issue. And where is the question of corruption? The person will be simply doing his job. That is why he is paid there. So democracy basically, friends, basically it means that we take care of the human dignity and respect human rights. And the last thing, of course, it is partnership. Like what today our University of Kannur, by having this wonderful what we call webinar, it is promoting harmony, and tomorrow we can all come together for a noble cause. Partnerships can be local, they can be regional, they can be global. And today's world is basically waiting for the rest of the world to come together. So I proceed a little further, and for the benefit of topic and also the respected teachers here, I have to do justice to the topic. I have to connect human rights to disaster management. Now here, whenever we are talking about disaster management, I'll come to the disasters as such slightly later, but let me focus on the Hyogo framework for action. Popularly, initials are HFA. And this is a very important framework adopted in Hyogo City of Japan. In the year 2005, 168 governments agreed. And they adopted a 10-year framework. The purpose was, because by the year 2005, the world had already recognized that several things were going astray. I'll come to the list slightly later. And they wanted to prevent further suffering to the citizens in every country. And thanks to United Nations, which has been relentlessly working on so many subjects at the same time. Like in India, sometimes we say Ashtavadanam or Shatavadanam, you know. Some of the ancient scholars, they have been doing 100 things, or they are in a position to attend to 100 questions at a single time. There's something like multi-staking and multiple tasks, doing multitasking, multiple tasks at the same time. Thanks to UN's innovative methods. So in the year 2005, in Kyoto, 168 nations came together and they agreed on a protocol, a framework for action. The highlights are just five, and therefore I wish to present to you. The first one is to ensure disaster risk reduction. That is, while framing a policy, the policy makers, that is the members of parliament in any given country, or the Senate or Congress or House of Lords or Commons, or whatever be the nomenclature of the parliaments of the world, you know, the most important thing is that they need to go and analyze the policy. Here, we call it as the policy impact studies. Policy impact studies. So they have to go and, they need to take all factors into consideration. Number one, they have to ensure that disaster risk reduction. It is very important. Most often the disaster is there hidden in the or implied in the policy itself, and governments become the source of these disasters. One popular example is what has been promoted in the name of green revolution in this country. We tend to think that green revolution has resulted in increased food production. That is true. To that extent, it is fine. But at what cost? Unfortunately, the negative aspects could have been avoided. But, you know, the whole country was in such a big hurry, and they went into it without applying their minds. And today the whole country is paying a very, very heavy price. As a result of this chemicalization of agriculture and hybridization of seeds, the topsoil in this country is completely contaminated. And, because of the pesticide residue in the food and the water and the air, wherever, you know, affecting the morbidity profile of the people of this country. And that is why every policy, it has to be studied in its entirety, its impact on everything has to be scrupulously done. But unfortunately, in most of the countries, behind every policy, there is a corporate entity. There's a corporate lobby which wants that kind of policy. And as a result, several things are going wrong. I'll come to it slightly later. So the first thing is to ensure that the policy, that disaster risk reduction, as a national and local, it should be a national and local priority, and there should be a strong institutional basis for implementation. Once a policy is agreed upon, the implementation should be left to strong institutions. And here I am reminded of T.N. Seshan. What a wonderful personality. The election commission was there earlier also, and the chief election commissioner, they were there, but one person made all the difference, and hats off to T.N. Seshan. See, the willpower, you know, one person should be dedicated to the constitution. It is not just one person, the entire institution should be dedicated to the constitution. Once, and the government also, you know, whatever be the party, they have to leave the institutions and let them function. They can't be interfering on a day-to-day basis. So the second thing that was agreed upon at Hyogo is to identify, assess and monitor disaster risks. Sometimes it appears there is some kind of a repetition. It is true, but then each word has a different connotation. And the system has to strengthen early warning system. That is, if there is a disaster waiting to happen, there should be a mechanism to warn. That kind of safety systems have to be built in. The third thing is, yes, all of us, we need to develop a culture of safety and resilience. That means that we, the people, should come together. We need to be vigilant and we need to be constantly conscious of the fact that something may go wrong. For example, people living in a not very far from a nuclear reactor, within the 30 kilometer radius. Don't ever think that nuclear reactors are symbols of development. They are basically disasters waiting to happen. You know, when the government of India wanted to locate a nuclear reactor at Nagarjuna Sagar, in the name of development, yes, we the people went and we opposed it in a most peaceful manner. And there was a debate between us and the then existing, Atomic Energy Commission people. And in that debate, they lost. They could not answer the kind of questions we raised. And therefore, they had to withdraw. That is why whenever the government proposes an activity, there should be a debate. A public hearing is mandatory, it is a must. Most often, the people have more knowledge than the government department people. So citizens' knowledge should be taken into consideration. People have what is known as the time-tested knowledge. It is traditional wisdom. It is this wisdom which the government has to benefit in framing a policy. Now I come to the fourth factor, is to reduce the underlying risk factors. This is, there are risk factors, they are there for anyone to see, but the government or the collectors, at any level, or the chief secretary or the people in power, they need to understand that they have to reduce or minimize or do away with the risk factors. In other words, there is what is known as the precautionary principle. I request all my young friends to please note that the precautionary principle should all constantly be there. Just as all of us, when it comes to our children or grandchildren, when they are crossing a road, we constantly tell them, look, be careful, look to the left and then to the right or whatever. And we sometimes go on repeating the same thing because they are our very dear ones. And we, by way of abundant precaution, we try to educate them, sensitize them. Same thing, the government has to bear in mind that it is we the people, and we gave a mandate to the political parties we gave a mandate to rule. They are there for a limited period of time. They need to do their job with a sense of responsibility and nothing more. The power should not get into their heads. They are, after all, public servants appointed by the public for a limited period of time. This most of the people in power forget, and particularly the problem is all the more because of a few chanchas around them. And lastly, friends, to enhance preparedness for effective response. So these are the five basic principles adopted at HUGO, and based on this HUGO framework for action, the Government of India in the year 2005, they established what is known as the National Disaster Management Authority. Now, this is, we have it popularly known as NDMA. NDMA is, I'll come to it one second. Yeah. I had the opportunity of presenting memorandums to the NDMA in the past. It is National Disaster Management works under the Home Ministry, but the Prime Minister chairs the meetings. And for a very long time, NDMA had a vice chairperson. At the national level, we have National Disaster Management Authority, but I have a grouse with the name itself. The NDMA name should be changed into National Disaster Prevention and Mitigation Authority, not management. Management presupposes that there should be a disaster and then these people enter to manage it. Whereas we can't afford to have disasters. Therefore, the title itself, National Disaster Prevention and Mitigation Authority, should be the name. I have given representation, but you know what happens in this country. Okay. Apart from the Prime Minister, it has roughly about 9 members. Sometimes the number can be less because, you know, our governments are a very slow moving mechanism and they hardly fill up the vacancies as and when they arise. Similarly, in every state, there should be a state disaster management authority. Even Kerala, you know, the state disaster management authority should be very well established, and it should be functional. When I say functional, there should be a duly constituted body and funds allotted and facilitated to work. Unfortunately, in most states, you know, for example, I come from Telangana, I know the State Disaster Management Authority is just there for naam ke vaste, that is namesake. In every state, you know, most of the State Disaster Management Authorities are dysfunctional. So what are they doing? They are violating the Yoga protocols. That is, even though at the national level we have NDMA, the state level, you know, the states are not having, they have not created strong institutions to function. And that's why we find all the states in this country moving from disaster to disaster. And nothing seems to be happening. Okay, friends, once again, coming back to human rights. I have something to tell you about the disasters at the global level. So normally we hear there are some disasters which right now they are not under control. One is cyclones, earthquakes, tsunamis. The rest, one or two extra, but the remaining, I think more 90% of the disasters are man-made. 90%, believe me. And these are even a drought could be as a result of negligence by the people and the government. Epidemics, the present case of pandemic, it is a failure of all the governments in the world. See, when it was known, when the first case in China was reported towards the end of December last, on December 31st, what was the world doing? I'll give you the example of India. We had NDMA, an institution which was very effective during Manmohan Singh time. Why did it become dysfunctional during, the last 6 years? And in fact, NDMA had a report, and that report was on pandemics. Why was the report not placed in public? Why did not the government immediately take the help of NDMA? And, you know, if they had entrusted the job to the institution already created under Hyogo, this country, you know, we could have avoided paying a very heavy price right now. Our economy is crippled, human rights have been violated. Think of the poorest of the poor, the migrant worker who were forced to move from one state to another state in search of livelihood. And what was the big situation? So all these, then I come to in the world's worst industrial accident. It took place in India, Bhopal. Chernobyl is a reminder. how things can go wrong, and that too in a superpower like USSR. There was also the Three Mile Island in America. Several dams in the world, they have burst. They are known as the dam bursts. Several dams have collapsed multiple times, and we have urban flooding, which is nothing but a man-made crisis. Bombay, which receives so much of rainfall, and every year, it's a shame that our financial capital city, where the richest of the rich live, a major part of the city is flooded. So a lot of things are happening, and I believe that it is we the people and our governments to blame. So far, not a single Indian political party is committed. You know, they have not openly said that they'll follow the sustainable development goals. Even earlier, they never pledged their support for the Millennium Development Goals. We have entered the 21st century. We have entered the new millennium with outdated political parties. They have no vision, no intention to serve the people, and a great majority of our MLAs and MPs, they operate as if they are the running dogs of the corporates. I'm very sorry to say, but I am compelled to say this. Now I go a little further. We have the concept of public interest litigation. And whenever I think of Kerala, I think of a very glorious personality, that is Justice Krishna Iyer, who lived for more than 100 years and who left a great mark on the judiciary of the country. He is the one who developed the public interest litigation concept. That is, any citizen of India can take up a public issue, an issue which is not common to a person, but to a community, to a locality, to a region, or to a great, it can be even nationwide. And you know what, I'm reminded of his very important quotation. He told the judiciary, don't think you are doing charity by going to the rescue of the poorest of the poor, or the marginalized, or the displaced, or the downtrodden, or people affected by public policies. It is your constitutional obligation. You have no choice. You have to go. That is, judiciary of India has to rise to the occasion and go to the pollution affected people or people suffering. This point, you know, it has saved India from many problems. Public interest litigations, as one, I have filed innumerable cases before the Supreme Court, before the National Human Rights Commission, State Human Rights Commission, and party in person, I have argued in almost all the courts, right from High Court to Supreme Court. And we have been winning because we work out, we go into the very depth of the subject, public policy, its impact, and we make impact studies and something. Okay, friends. So I request all of you to please focus on whenever we are talking about human rights, we are talking about fundamental rights in India, part 3, focus on fundamental rights. And part 4, that is directive principles of state policy, they focus on the social and economic rights. When it comes to fundamental rights, yes, we are right to life, right to, equality, freedom, right against exploitation, freedom of religion, cultural and educational rights, right to constitutional remedies. So we have excellent constitution. And our constitutional fathers, they have taken care to provide us. I think I have taken a lot of time, and one last difficulty I wish to bring to your notice, and that is, suppose we file a public interest litigation and we work very hard and we provide all the information, and let us assume Even the judges are very excellent people, and they rise to the occasion, and they give excellent order. You know what the difficulty is? We have a bureaucracy, a steel frame. You know, the IAS people, the IPS people, or the state local political parties. Particularly in India, most of the local political parties, they are even more dictatorial than the national parties. As a result, even the hard work rendered by the citizens, you know, the entire work of going to the judiciary and approaching them and waiting for 2 years, 3 years, finally when they win the battle and when they get extraordinary orders, I'm very sorry to say that these orders are not complied with. This is the word. They are not implemented. Now, what is the remedy? Yes, on paper we have remedy. And we think, yes, we can file a contempt. Yes. For example, in Patancheru industrial area case, we got 40 orders from the Supreme Court, thanks to M.C. Mehta, India's best known enviro legal lawyer. He did it free for us. And those 40 orders were not implemented. Then we had, then the Supreme Court asked the High Court to intervene and take care. High Court did not do the job. Meanwhile, NGT was created, and National Green Tribunal, you know, it was created, and it has its headquarters in Delhi. And in addition to that, we have regional offices in Chennai, etc. So the case was transferred to Chennai, and finally, you know, after very hard work of more than 33 years, the Chennai court gives very routine type of orders. It orders that a hospital should be built, and some remedy should be given to the affected people. 33 years of valuable life is lost. A whole generation has suffered. Hundreds of people died, and their lands are completely polluted. Their water is polluted. Their livelihoods are lost. India, definitely we have a good constitution. Some of the judges are excellent, but the system is not perfect. Friends, it is we, the college teachers, yes, all of us, we need to be vigilant. We have to do the sensitization work. We need to stand by the suffering people. And of course, we may lose valuable time, we may lose many opportunities. But the greatest satisfaction we will have, that is, we have stood by the suffering masses. It is important. Otherwise, what is the fun of our education? So, we, all of us, we have to dedicate ourselves to the cause of the Constitution, the people, our human rights. And right now, there's a big crisis, that is, there is a climate emergency. Tomorrow may be too late, and we the people in this country, we are moving very, very slowly, very slowly. And we think there is no problem, which is wrong. We need to be in touch with the big debate that is going on at the global level. I thank the organizers, the principals, the respected principals, distinguished faculty, for the wonderful opportunity given to me, and I will remain. If there are any questions, I can. Thank you very much. God bless you.
Thank you, sir. Sir, am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Sir, you gave all inclusive idea of democracy from the very beginning of Athenian democracy, which was the first known democracy in the world, then about monarchy and aristocracy. And the Universal Declaration of Human Rights is a milestone document in the history of human rights. And also you rightly pointed out that credited with cleaning up Indian elections as chief election commissioner of T.N. Sheshan, who is widely seen as legend, who enforced the model code of conduct for the first time. and invoked fear in politicians for his ruthless approach. And sir, I have a question. While Indian laws on rape, dowry, and adultery have women's safety at heart, these highly discriminatory practices are still taking place at an alarming rate, affecting the lives of many today. What do you say about it, sir? It's really shame for us.
Yeah, it's a very valid question. As I already pointed out in Sustainable Development Goal, Goal number 5 talks about gender equity. And this can be realized. Most often we see the mother-in-law also is a woman, and that apart. We as a society, we are, all of us collectively, we have failed the ladies, the women in this country. And even on the road, you know, if some girl is being harassed or, you know, if there is a problem, none of the male members stand there and, you know, try to comfort or be supportive. Suppose our own sister or daughter is there, that kind of approach should be there. But it is not just a dowry, madam. Many things have gone wrong when it comes to the ladies. I'll tell you, not till 1928, even in the so-called Madras Parliament, that is UK, women did not have the right to vote, 1928. And even in America, women did not have the right to work till the 20th century. And it was much later that the blacks started getting. So there has been continuous discrimination, continuous whole sections have been, white sections of people have been segregated, humiliated, and there is no dignity. So basically, it requires for a change of mindset, particularly from the males. We, the people, we have to realize that we have, each one of us has a great responsibility. And that's why we, India requires something like an eternal vigilance. Yes, we need to be vigilant continuously. And if there is harassment or segregation or, you know, somebody is isolated, identified and tortured, then particularly the educated among us, if we just go and stand. Recently, you know, I'll give you the best example. And there is Eastern Ghats, you know, Eastern Ghats. And in that, there is a very wonderful forest known as Nallamala. It's a Tamil name meaning a very good mountain. And there's so much of biodiversity there. And so the government of India wanted to go in for uranium mining. And the Adivasis, they just gave me a call and I went there. And I explained to them about the implications of uranium mining and all that. Believe me, after that, of course, I went about 3-4 times. But even if I had not gone, or people like me had not gone. With the advent of the social media, the sensitization was done in less than 1 month. And 5 assembly segments area in Telangana were so sensitized that it became extremely difficult for the ruling party MLAs. And they all went and approached the chief minister, and the chief minister was compelled to announce in the assembly that they will not allow uranium mining. One good news today is, today's India is different. In every home, even in Telangana, I know about Kerala, nearly 100% education, literacy, you know, women are highly educated, they are confident. But even in Telangana, today's situation is everybody has a home, pakka house, there is a TV, a two-wheeler, motorcycle, and there is a smartphone. And more than that, there is every home has a graduate. And you can imagine, today we can bring about change so very easily. I'm sure by the next 1 or 2 years, many of these issues like, you know, harassment of women, etc. And I'm sure in the days to come it will be addressed.
Sir, I have one question.
Okay.
First of all, I thank you for an informative and mind-opening presentation. Sir, I have a question. As you have pointed out, the environmental conservation is a prominent issue connected to human rights protection.
Slightly louder, then.
I have a question.
Yeah.
You have pointed out environmental conservation is a prominent issue connected to human rights protection. Sir, we also do hear that the development countries are using poor countries like Africa as their dumping yard of electronic waste. That the amount to violation of human rights, whether any international protocols to prohibit such actions?
It's very easy, madam. The Western world or the first world, the industrialized world thinks that they can dump anywhere and get out. I mean, irresponsibly they can dump their waste anywhere in the oceans of the world. And all this is happening because our own rulers are tacitly silent. And they are silent because we, the voters, we are silent. In a democracy, the starting point is the voter, the citizens. It is we, the people, who need to be vigilant. So we have to continue to be vigilant. We need to connect to the society, sensitize them, motivate them. And whenever any such thing comes, we should take up the issue. The policy analysis should be done in the colleges and the universities, and the university teachers should be with the people, helping them, guiding them, because the prime task here is that we are not just teachers for the classroom. We are teachers for the society, and if necessary, we'll teach the governments also a lesson. This should be our approach. The four walls of the classroom shall not stop us. Yes. In Hyderabad, we are there every day on the TV, we are being quoted, and we succeed like anything. Believe me, at least a 40 to 45 major success stories regarding, we got so many orders. And the recent one is regarding our river Musi. And there is a river which passes through Hyderabad. And we got a retired High Court judge appointed as a Judicial Commission. So we, the teachers, because we are the most educated persons in society. Even what is an IAS officer, even that officer is like our student. And what is the education coordinator? They do some graduation, they write some exam. If they are lucky, they'll get it. But whereas an average teacher is a postgraduate, MPhil, PhD and whatnot. Sometimes it is double PhD. Or double MA, double masters. There used to be so much knowledge, information. Why should we be silent? And when there is a protective constitution, nobody can touch us. We have to create the right kind of pressure on the political system, compel them. If not, let us all come together and start a Green Party. Why not? Article 51A, it says, protection of environment is everybody's fundamental duty. So to protect, we need to come together. If necessary, we'll start a political party with our manifesto will be sustainable development goals. And no, nobody can improve on it. That is the best manifesto. And we can change public opinion. So let us all come together nationwide. Now, anyhow, webinars are facilitating interaction. So use this for a better purpose, and we'll start a Green Party at the national level. And you should be the president of the Kerala unit. Thank you, madam, for the wonderful opportunity.
Thank you so much. So, yeah.
Thank you, sir. There are a lot of appreciations in the chat boxes from participants, sir. And also a few queries are there. Shall I pick some for you, sir?
Pardon, ma'am.
Few questions from participants' side. Shall
I pick please, some please.
From one Dr. Chitra. So thank you for the valuable insights. Is in the possibility of using human rights to protect the environment limited to anthropocentrism of human rights? Shouldn't there be proper definitions of basic concepts of human rights, as we have to think on different scales, different contexts, and different cultures as part of global capitalist system and as members of dominant species? Is it clear for you, sir? I think the question
The question itself is very big.
Very big, yeah.
Yeah, yes, just sir. Summarize, madam.
She want to know, is there any proper definition of basic concept of human rights?
No, it is already very well defined, not only at the UN level, but the very idea of human rights. We are all human beings, okay? Yes. Now, you just, it's very easy. All of us want to be free. We need to think, we need to practice what, whether we go to any place of worship or not, that is our choice. Yes. But if we want to worship, yes, it is our freedom. It is not just religion, cultural practices, or our profession. You know why profession is included in the fundamental rights? Because earlier there was this problem. In the villages particularly, people used to inherit a profession. And if that particular person deviated from that, people would question that. Of course, it's a sign of backwardness. So that has changed now. Today, it is anybody can take up any activity. There is absolutely mobility between the professions. A farmer's son can become a doctor, can become a lawyer, whatever it is. So it is left to them. Ultimately, human rights are nothing but the expressions of the person to develop as per his aptitude and aspirations. And now, the at least on paper, the national education policy provides. But I have very serious doubts because, on one side they promise everything, but on the other side they have taken away the what we call draft environmental impact assessment, the EIA.
EIA, yes.
Yeah, there again they are opening the doors for the corporates. They are silencing the people. See, you cannot have, on one side you cannot appear to be democratic and on the other. So there should be transparency, there should be compatibility between the policies of the government. Human rights, that is what actually distinguishes a developed society. Yes, we Indians, definitely one more, I want to appreciate India on one count. See, one point for all the youngsters here. See, we became free in 1947. But along with us, slightly before and after, nearly 100 countries became free. They also got liberated from colonialism and imperialism. But very few countries could retain at least the democratic fabric. India continues to be a democracy. And Indian Supreme Court continues to play a wonderful role. The basic structure, recently Keshavananda Bharati ji is no more. But what a massive contribution. His original case is different, but then the judgment came in favor of basic structure, thanks to Nani Palkiwala. So his contribution is there. And we are all extremely grateful to that judgment. It saved democracy in this country. But that is not sufficient. We, the people, need to be vigilant and we need to be contributing almost on a daily basis. In fact, it is expected that the enlightened sections of India will rise to the occasion.
Sir, I have a question. What do you think about welcoming foreign universities to India, quoted in new NEP 2020?
No, we should, again, the same problem, madam. We cannot be viewing it in isolation. See, for anything, it can be a blessing. provided we are vigilant. But it can also be exploitation, because they can be selling certificates and making money. So, but again, not only foreign universities. In Telangana, we have recently given 4 private universities. What is the guarantee that our own people will not be just commercial? And one more point, please remember that education it should be in the service field. Nobody can make business out of it. But in India, the private universities are converting it into a business proposition. The corporates have entered the fray, and they are entering only to make more money. So it is a very critical time for all of us. We need to protect our education, save education, and save democracy. Simultaneously, all of us should be doing multitasking when it comes to the protection of the freedoms.
Thank you, sir. We have another question from Mr. Jayakrishnan. This is the era of technology. Do you think it contributes for sustainable development?
Which technology?
That he not mentioned, sir. Era of technology. Do you think? Excuse me, Mr. Jayakrishnan, are you there? No. Then another question. How does government policy may help directly in solution of limitations of disaster management?
By anticipating. Here there is a very important concept that is known as the precautionary principle. For every policy, the most important thing is that by way of abundant precaution, the government should. So what is the procedure now? They have to make environmental impact assessment. And then they should keep the report with the people. When I say with the people, in the area where that kind of development is being proposed, with the collector, with the revenue divisional officer, and all public buildings, schools or a college or a hospital, so that the common man of India living in that area, who is a stakeholder, they can go and take a copy. In addition to that, the summary, when I say summary, the basic its impact on the people and the environment, it should be published in the local papers. And after that, give 1 month time and facilitate a genuine discussion. This is known as environmental public hearing. Now, what's happening is the present central government, it wants to silence the people. It wants to do away public hearing. They have reduced the time, which normally earlier it was 30 days. Now they want to reduce it to 20 days. And they want to basically, they are expecting that the industry which will pollute, that industry itself will bring their problems to the notice of the pollution control board. And what the government is now saying, it is a joke. They are telling that the citizens cannot report about the damages from the industry. That is, they can't say that the industry is polluting. I mean, all these things are there in the draft EIA, which we have questioned. And the beauty in this country is nearly 25 lakh, 2.5 million objections have come. And that is the beauty of this country. That is why I say this country is still safe. See, with the technology emerging, just as because there is internet, we are able to discuss in a webinar, right? We are able to have a lecture and an interaction. Similarly, the people in this country, they are using internet to raise their objections. 25 lakh objections on the draft EIA, and the number is increasing, and the governments have become shaky. So it means people are rising to the occasion and they'll play the role expected of them.
Yes, sir.
Shriya.
Yes, another question. Yes.
Mr. Jayakrishnan is there, Shriya.
Yeah, okay.
He asked a question.
Jayakrishnan? Mr. Jayakrishnan, are you there?
Yes, unmute, yes, sir. Yeah.
Please unmute your microphone and you may ask. There?
Mr. Jayakrishnan, you are there and you could even.
Mr. Jayakrishnan, please unmute your microphone.
He has done it, but I think that he couldn't speak. He has done it already.
Okay. Shall I pass on to the next question?
Yes, you pass on, Shriya, to the next question. Let Jayakrishnan come at the line.
Okay. So another question from Sri Sudhir Gopal. Even after the gross negligence of an MNC like this, like the Union Carbide stands proved, our system have failed in charging or getting any proper compensation for the victims of Bhopal tragedy, even after many decades. Don't you think that shows an inherent weakness of our system?
No, no. See, one point I want to... You asked a very valid question. It's a very, very important question.
Yeah.
In fact, I became an environmentalist exactly 1 month after Bhopal gas disaster. Moved by that particular disaster. And certain developments took place in Hyderabad city and suddenly I was drawn into it. Now, what happened in Bhopal is... It is the world's worst industrial accident. A multinational corporation known by Union Carbide, their unit in Bhopal, you know, something went wrong and the great disaster took place. More than 4,000 people died within 2 hours. And it's the world's worst industrial accident took place in India, right? And that was the time when India lost, I'm not saying we lost our Prime Minister, Madam Gandhi. A new person, her son, became the Prime Minister. He was a novice. I'm not finding excuses, but in this country, the value of human life is zero. Nobody bothers. And you know, when Mr. Warren, the chairman of the company, came to India, he was taken around and shown by the chief minister of Madhya Pradesh. And finally, same day, the person leaves and he's seen off by the chief minister. And the person, you know, he is responsible for thousands of people death. And he should have been prosecuted in the Indian court. Why was he allowed to leave the country? So, in this country, when politicians are for sale, when they become the running dogs of the corporates, it is we, the people, who suffer. That is why. But to ensure that politicians are loyal to the people, it is we, the people, we should become active. Yes, eternal vigilance is the price we need to pay. We have all kinds of laws, but I want to be very clear. Right now, almost all political parties are playing to the tunes of the corporates. And it is a matter of grave concern. The common interests of the people of this country are being compromised. Our common property resources are being transferred to the corporates. Every day, we, the people, are becoming poorer because our wealth is going to the hands of the corporates. So there are larger issues. System is good. System depends upon the strength of the citizens. If all of us are determined, we can take care of India. And one last point. You know, there is what is known as equity. So environment as a subject, it talks about equity within a nation. It talks about equity between nations and between generations. So I request all of you to remember, we are talking about equity within a nation, between the nations, and between generations. We all need to be vigilant, not only for ourselves, for the welfare of the coming generations. And this should be the norm in all the countries of the world. It's not one. Just India alone will not be able to save the planet Earth. Yes, we need to do our bit. We made tall promises in international conferences. We promised a 30% reduction in the emissions. We need to do our bit to reduce our carbon footprint. Thank you, ma'am.
Sir, one more question. May I pay? Sir?
Yeah, please.
One more question, may I?
Yes, sir. Yeah.
From Mr. Dheeraj Ambade. He expected something on Hathras.
On?
Hathras issue. Perhaps we hesitate to discuss even as the literary discourse.
Yes. Sorry, I didn't get it.
He expected something on Hathras, discussion on Hathras.
What is that? I need to be enlightened. Hathras.
Yeah.
What is it?
Dheeraj? Mr. Dheeraj? You there?
Dheeraj?
Dheeraj? No.
Is there?
No, sir. Not responding.
Sorry, I don't know, ma'am. What is the... Can you explain what is the question?
I think the recent rape case.
Oh,
yeah.
Sorry.
So it's not a platform for our discussion.
Yeah. But anyway, I have already commented that whenever such things happen, it is the entire society which should take the responsibility. Yes. We are all to be blamed. These things are happening because we are not vigilant. And we should, the punishment should be instantaneous. It can't go on for years together. And one point I have always been telling, it is rule of law. The law should be same for everyone. And the application, everyone, you know, application should be equal application of laws. As a political scientist, rule of law is the most important thing. We can't discriminate between victims.
Still discrimination is there, sir, prevailing.
Yes, it is there, but yeah. we have to stand by the suffering.
All the laws are in papers only.
On paper, yes. I told you, no, not only we are getting excellent orders, but they are not implemented.
Yes.
So, that requires some kind of a mini demonstration by the citizens. Yes. We should all observe more number of days for democracy and rule of law. We are planning, recently we had 4 meetings on the International Day for Democracy. And now on September 15th and January we are having another. So continuously we have to strengthen democracy, we need to discuss. And for that, dialogue is the only thing. Because we can't take to violence. We don't believe in violence. We can only strengthen India with the help of discussion. So we have to demonstrate.
Okay, thank you, sir. Another question, may I?
Yeah, please.
From Sri Sudhir Gobal. After 73 years and having the best constitution in the world, we still have to be ashamed of a social situation resulting in Kathua, Unnao, Hathras, etc., how India can escape from this kind of social mindset and improve to a better democracy? The same.
Yeah, only one sentence will explain, and that is, if only, yeah, we need to understand what was the spirit of the Constituent Assembly while drafting the Constitution. So with the same spirit, we should implement the Constitution. That is, we should walk the talk. Whatever was the spirit of the, or the original intention of Dr. Ambedkar and, you know, his team there, that has to be implemented in the same spirit. But here now, as I already pointed out, it is not the people's voice that is reflected in Parliament. It is the corporate voice that is reflected. A few people, their vested interest, every day the government, you know, not just one party, but most Indian political parties. And that's the reason people are being marginalized. And that's the reason, that is the cause for our disillusionment with the Constitution. But in fact, the fault is not with the Constitution. It is we, the people, who at the time of elections, we forget our responsibility and we vote as per our caste and religion and language and whatever. And we also vote taking money or a liquor bottle. It is we, the people, the great majority of the people, who compromise for a single day and suffer in silence for 5 years.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Anything else?
Dear participants, any queries? Meera? No.
No, no. What's the
session?
So, may I? Vote of thanks. Before vote of thanks, I have a small request. Because, you know, Kerala is the most informed state. It's God's own land. All of you are so wonderful, so vigilant. I request all of you to form an environmental protection society. Because by form, and this will be a value addition to the college and the university. So take the lead, and Kannur University should be in the forefront when it comes to protection of environment and human rights. With this, I thank Dr. Meera and the entire distinguished faculty, you know, for giving me this wonderful opportunity. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yes, sir, a lot of observation from me, Dr. Yeah. from the Department of English.
Yeah.
It's really, you know, amazing for me to listen to you. For 2 hours, you were speaking with that energy and inspiring us. And also, definitely, we will, you know, follow your request.
Yeah. That, thank you. Thank you.
Yeah. We, our college is working hard to protect environment, and our NSS units are doing, and all the departments are doing, sir. Definitely, we promise you that we will be doing that with the most sincerity and loyalty and passion, sir. Thank you so much.
And one point, recently, we published a book on the Eastern Ghats. My students and myself. A wonderful book, a world-class book. And it was released by Pranab Mukherjee just about 8 months ago in Delhi before Corona. So I'll send the soft copy immediately.
By tomorrow, sir.
It will be. And just it's a case study. You can make such reports, right? Basically, every college should be, you know, like a fountain of knowledge, continuous research, and ready, easily available to the people on consumer rights, on human rights, on environmental rights, right to life, right to livelihood. I appreciate the topic which you have chosen. Yes, everybody should be, you know, active and doing their bit to protect the rights, our rights. Otherwise, we'll become slaves again.
Yes, of course.
So we have to do our bit. Okay.
Sure, sir.
Thank you.
Sure, sir.
Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you so much.
Let me invite Dr. Radha to deliver the vote of thanks.
Sriya, before that, can I make an announcement what Meera has told me?
What? Okay.
Radha, sorry. The thing is, dear participants, we the organizing committee and the IIC, our IIC family, Institution Innovation Council, we have planned, decided to bring a book on human rights. I know that all the participants are from different faculty, that is departments or maybe in streams, different streams. And we look forward from you. The articles maybe on your department, on your area, any area, you can, that should be related to human rights. You can send it to us so that we will just segregate it as the same category. And we love to produce or publish a book on human rights in connection with this short-term program by the renowned publisher from Delhi or Mumbai. Two publishers we are looking forward. And so it will be totally free and you will be getting your copy, hard print copy. And you are you can very freely contact us if you have any doubt. And also we will give all the clarifications, everything in the final day. And looking forward from you, your support and everything. Thank you.
Dr. Rao, thank you, Dr. Janada.
Thank you.
I welcome Dr. Radha to propose vote of thanks.
Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
Respected and most distinguished chief guest of the day, respected principal, honorable professors, and my dear participants, I stand before you with a deep sense of honor, privilege, and humility to propose the vote of thanks to all who have helped us in making the second day of this short-term course a resounding success. First of all, I would like to propose my heartfelt thanks to our chief guest, Professor Purushottaman Reddy, former professor of political science, Osmania University, for gracing today's session of the short-term course. Thank you, sir, for your interesting and thought-provoking address. You very well said that we cannot talk about human rights without democracy. You certainly have made the society as your lab, and most part of your life have been dedicated for the cause of society and environment. We bow before your simplicity, sir. You have made outstanding moments and great victories for the people and the environment with a sense of humbleness, and you have attributed all your successes to the benevolent God. We are really enlightened with your knowledge and presence. Thank you, sir. Then I would like to express my profound gratitude to Dr. A.M. Sridharan, Director, UGC HRDC, Kannur University, Kerala, for collaborating with us for conducting this short-term course. Your generous support has provided great strength to us in jointly organizing this short-term course. I would like to propose my heartfelt thanks to our principal, Dr. K.V. Jayashree, who have guided us in the right direction and stood as a great pillar of support. Thank you, ma'am. Let me place on record my sincere and heartfelt thanks to IQAC coordinator of our college, Dr. K. Meena, and IIC president, Dr. Smita Nair, and all the members of IIC for their guidance and extended to us throughout the program. I wish to acknowledge the untiring efforts of young, vibrant, enthusiastic organizing secretaries, Dr. Janata Kumari, Dr. Meera, and Dr. Anita, and the scientific committee members towards the success of this short-term course. I extend a special thanks to each one of them. They have worked hard and deserve a special round of applause. Then I would like to thank the technical help rendered by Mr. Abhijit for the smooth conduct of this program. And finally, the wonderful participants who have turned up in such a great number. Thank you so much for your kind cooperation. Once again, I thank all for your active participation. Thank you, one and all.
Thank you, Dr. Radha. Dear participants, we hope to see you all again tomorrow evening at the same time, at the same platform, without fail, to listen to the talk of Ambassador Sri T.P. Srinivasan Ji on role of the United Nations in human rights. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you all.
Thank you.